حي على العزاء يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين حي على البكاء يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين هب ريح الدموع وايام الخشوع
حشراتك ضميت كلماتك بيني العابرة حنيت لمصابك ونيت يم بابك تانيت لجوابك يا ابني استغرى شما اشتاق انا لعطرك تربة مرقدك اشتم ذكرك لو يمر على البال صاحي وباسمك اتحلم كل موكب من اسمع صوت يا حسين اتألم ذبتك لو سمه يا بن فاطمة راية مرقدك لو لامست خد الهوى يموت ما شفتك لجن صرت انت الوطن يا ما اسمع تراث البي عشيت كل عمري عالصوت يا اول عشيت حملني جروح انا دهون البشر محبوبي مذبوح محبوبي حسين
محبوبي حسين يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين
روحي ضميتك عمري سميتك بقلبي حاجيتك عيني تشوفك أقراك ليلي بجيك يومي عمري وتالي بيني جفوفك أمشي بديرتي وانظر نارا حبجي لهمومك دود البس ثياب السود يلي سلبه وهدومك حرم العزا كيفوح وعرف جي اقرب يومك انشر لك لواء اعلان العزا حزنك نجتمع بالخيمة وين واس الزجية رب العاشقين انت يا حسين خليت القلب كل دهر عايش بالرزية دمعت مجلسك بس عاشتي الروح انا دون البشر محبوبي مذبوح محبوبي حسين
محبوبي حسين هب ريح الدموع وايام الخشوع تنتظر السنه يا محرم دمعتي العين حي على العزاء حي على
ضيعني شايل بسنيني بس يحروفك ذكرك قران يسمعك بلساني كعبت ايماني وقلبي يطوفك حن عليك قلبي بشوق حنت والده وتفقد مو مره ليف مره اجي ينبابك واقعد من نورك اضيع شلون وانا البس اليك اشرد اتنفس هواك تحويني بلواك يا اقدس عشيرة الانتمي الها بحياتي عايف كل هواي ضامي وانت ماي حسن الخاتمة يعني
حزنك ينوح أنا دون البشر محبوبي مذبوح محبوبي حسين
محبوبي حسين
مشکی میپوشم گرمه چاووشم یاده شش گوشم دوستت دارم
ای اصل ایمان ای جان جانان عشق بی پایان دوستت دارم
کاری کن تسلای قلب مادرت باشم
امسالم مثل هر سال آقا نوکرت باشم روز و شب پریشون جسم بی سرت باشم
نزدیک غمت ماه ماتمت امسالم الهی که محرم رو ببینم
بیتابم حسین اربابم حسین
از حالا به فکر کربلا و اربعینم
کاشکی اربعین با دست ساقی
مهمونم کنی چای عراقی محبوبی حسین
محبوبی حسین ابری حدمون و ایام الخشور تنتظر السنازل یا محرم دمعتی على العزاء حي على البكاء اسمع فاطمة تنادي تعال ون على حسين بنفاسي عطر عاشور كيفوح أنا دون البشر محبوبي مذبوح محبوبي حسين محبوبي
حسين ضيعني شايل بسني
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الرحمن علم القرآن خلق الإنسان علمه البيان الشمس والقمر بحسبان والنجم والشجر يسجدان والسماء رفعها وضع الميزان ألا تطغوا في الميزان وأقيموا الوزن بالقسط ولا تخسروا الميزان والأرض وضعها للأنام فيها فاكهة والنخل ذات الأكمام والحب ذو العصف والريحان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان خلق الإنسان من صلصال كالفخار وخلق الجان من مارج من نار فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان رب المشرقين ورب المغربين فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان بأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان يخرج منهما اللؤلؤ والمرجان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان وله الجوار المنشأت في البحر كالأعلام فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان كل من عليهما فان ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان يسأله من في السماوات والأرض كل يوم هو في الشأن فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان سنفرغ لكم أيها الثقلان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان أعوذ بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. Thank you for joining us for these Muharram lecture series presented by Al Hussain Youth. We kindly ask you to follow us for up-to-date info on our programs and events through our Instagram page and WhatsApp. Please note that the lectures are available after the end of the program on our YouTube channel. And without further ado, please welcome Sheikh Ahmed Bazi with Salawat. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
أتوب الله وصلوات على محمد وآل محمد for the love of أم البنين عليه السلام. And another loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad for the love of Abul Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ajjil farajahum wa la'an a'da'ahum. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا حبيب الله صلى الله عليك يا مولاي وابن مولاي يا أبا عبد الله الحسين يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة غريب يا مظلوم كربلاء يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز والله فوزا عظيما. For the love of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, let's have a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. For the love of his father, Amir al-Mu'mineen, let's have another loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Lastly, for the love of Sahib al-Asri wa al-Zaman, let's have another loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Tonight is the night of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam Allah. And tonight, my brothers and sisters, I could have chose to discuss a topic where I had to analyze and dissect and discuss and expand and contract on an issue and compress. But I chose one topic and one title to begin with. Rather, one statement, one word, and that is, let me describe to you, let me tell you about Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Let me tell you about the man who defined what it meant to be a man, the brother that defined what it meant to be a brother, the commander that defined what it meant to be a man of merit and value and justice, a man whose loyalty spoke before his words, a man whose compassion and passion for Ahlul Bayt alayhim salamullah, acted before his hands moved in the man whose love for Abi Abdullah al-Hussein tore in the deserts of Karbala the armies apart and laid down a path for Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam that no one could stand in front of. This Abbas, my brothers and sisters, is a man that if I try to describe and analyze, try to understand fully, I won't be able to. Not because Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas is one that cannot be understood or described, but a small soul like me can't begin to understand Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam can only be defined and described by who he was on the battlefield on Ashura in Karbala, and can be described by how those who knew him described him. For us to understand Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas will be very, very difficult. So let me just tell you about Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, and you yourself put the puzzle together and paint an image. So that's exactly what we're going to do, my brothers and sisters. We are going to paint an image of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas tonight. I'm going to try my best to paint for you a portrait of who al-Abbas ibn Ali alayhi salam was. And I won't begin on his stance in Ashura and Karbala. I won't begin from there. I'll begin almost 30 years before that day. Almost 30 years before the day of Ashura, when Imam Ali alayhi salam lost Sayyida Fatima alayhi salam. I'm going to paint for you that picture. We're going to paint it together. But before it, Allah salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. It said Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam lost to Zahra. And now Imam Ali alayhi salam is faced with a decision. Rather, he's faced with a problem before a decision. And that problem, my brothers and sisters, is the men, the ummah, the nation crossed the red line. And that was Fatima alayhi salam. They came into the house of Amir al-Mu'mineen, burnt the house of Sayyida Fatima alayha salam down on her. And when the man was asked, would you break the house down with Fatima inside? He said, wa in. He doesn't care. And so the ummah made it clear what is to happen to Hussein, to Hassan, to Zainab, to Kulthum, to Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah in the future. Amir al-Mu'mineen knew the future of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah was grim. And that Imam al-Hussein, Imam al-Hassan need supporters and protectors, those that are going to be loyal to them to the last breath. So Imam Ali alayhi salam goes to his brother by the name of Aqil. He says to him, Ya Aqil, I want you to find me a woman that comes from a lineage of warriors, lineage of brave men. I want you to find me a woman وَلَدَتْهَا فُحُولَةُ الْعَرَبِ, a woman who the warriors of the Arabs gave birth to. Why? So that she can give me a warrior that will stand with my son on the day of Ashura. Aqil alayhi salamullah alayhi ridwanullah. He says to Imam Ali alayhi salam, then don't look further than Fatima bint Hizam al-Kilabiyya. This woman comes from a progeny, comes from a tribe that is known for their bravery and their courage. So Aqil went to the tribe, asked for Umm al-Baneen's hand in marriage, Fatima bint Hizam al-Kilabiyya. And when her father heard the news, heard that Imam Ali alayhi salam wanted Fatima, Umm al-Baneen, for Imam Ali alayhi salam, he was very happy, very excited, very honored that Imam Ali alayhi salam wanted his daughter. So he gave his daughter in marriage to Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. But what was Imam Ali alayhi salam looking for? As in, who were those warriors? Where did al-Abbas alayhi salam come from? Who are the forefathers of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam? You want to know the courage of Abu al-Fadl, then know where he came from. For the seed of an individual is what tells you if that tree is going to be strong or if it's going to be flimsy. From the seed, from how that seed was brought up, where that seed came from. It's a healthy seed or if it's a rotten seed. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas seed, my brothers and sisters, is one that the Arabs themselves, Muslim, non-Muslim, salute. His progeny was known. As for the great uncle of Umm al-Baneen, his name was Amir ibn al-Tufayl. Amir ibn al-Tufayl was a valiant, courageous warrior that was not only known for his bravery on the battlefield, but he was also known for his honor, generosity, respect. It's said that the Caesar of Rome, when he came down to Arabia, he would come and visit Amir ibn al-Tufayl, a man of courage, but also a man of morals and merit, Fadl, honor. As for their great grandfather of Umm al-Baneen, of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, a man by the name of Amir ibn Malik. Amir ibn Malik, my brothers and sisters, was also a man known for his bravery and his courage, and not just his courage, his aggression on the battlefield. To the degree where he was named Mula'ib al-Asinna. What's Mula'ib al-Asinna mean? Mula'ib al-Asinna is the man who plays with the tips of the spears. Either in front of the spear, he's able to dodge and move to the point where it's as if he's playing with the tip of the spear. Or that when he holds the spears, he has flow with the spears to the point where they're almost like his hands. And he's playing with the spears in his hands. That's how brave he was. Mula'ib al-Asinna. And by the way, the person who has the trait of the one who plays with something, it's not that he just does it once or twice. No, he does it constantly. He's constantly in front of the spears. He constantly has the spears in his hands. And the spears are something that he sees so familiar to himself, like the hands of an individual. Mula'ib al-Asinna. The valiant warrior, Amr ibn Malik. And not just was he valiant, and not just was he courageous, but also honorable, respected amongst the Arabs. Jamil. Then we have Al-Tufayl, who was the father of Amr ibn al-Tufayl. Al-Tufayl was also a valiant, courageous warrior, and he was one of four brothers. Their mother was named Umm al-Baneen as well. Their mother was named Umm al-Baneen. This man was also respected and known for his courage, and his three brothers were also known for their courage. The same way Umm al-Baneen alayhi salam was named Umm al-Baneen because she had Ja'far, Uthman, Abdullah, and Al-Abbas. This man's mother, Al-Tufayl, she also had four sons. One of them was Al-Tufayl, and she was named Umm al-Baneen. Lastly, we have Urwa ibn Utbah, which was also the great-grandfather of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas from Umm al-Baneen, alayhi salam. This man was known for his generosity. He was known for his honor, his respect, and it's said that the kings of the time used to be honored by him when he comes to their courtrooms, when he comes to their palaces. They used to welcome him. This is the lineage of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas from the mother. As for the father, haddith wa la haraj. As for the father, he is none other than Amir al-Mu'mineen, wa qaid al-ghurr al-muhajjaleen, ila jannat al-na'im, Ali ibn Abi Talib, asadullah al-ghalib. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. He is none other than Ali ibn Abi Talib, the one who used to go down to the battlefield and control the battlefield with just his aura, his dominance. The one who stood up in front of Amir bin Wudd al-Amiri, who was equal to 1,000 men in the Battle of Al-Ahzab, Al-Khandaq, and destroys Amir bin Wudd, hence destroying an army around him, behind him. Ali alayhi salam, whose stare, whose look used to pierce the hearts of those who stood in front of him, made them petrified the men who stood in front of him. His uncle Hamza. His uncle Hamza, who was Asadullah wa Asadu Rasulih, the lion of Allah, the lion of Rasul, the man, who when he fought in Badr, when he fought in Badr, the ma'araka, the entire battlefield trembled when he came down. It said that Hamza used to wrestle lions. Al-Hamza was so big and so strong that he would be able to wrestle beasts, the beasts of the desert. This is Al-Hamza alayhi salam Allah. Shaheed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the forefathers. And it said Banu Hashim, my brothers and sisters, were known to be very big and very strong. They were known to be very big, very strong, very courageous individuals. This is the lineage of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam. As for Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas's birth, he was born in 26 after Hijrah. Meaning that Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was in his mid-30s around Ashura. It said that Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam was born a healthy, strong young boy. And Imam Ali alayhi salam wanted to name him. And as we say, al-musamma la yunbi'u an waqi' or al-ism, afwan. Al-ism la yunbi'u an waqi' al-musamma. We say in Hawza that the name, ism al-alam, the name that we give something or someone, doesn't actually describe the reality of the person. Yeah, and if I was to name my son Kareem, my son doesn't have to grow up and be generous. The word Kareem means generous. When my son grows up, he doesn't have to be generous. He could be a stingy individual. This law applies to everyone except Ahlul Bayt, alayhi salam. For when Ahlul Bayt names someone, when Al-Baqir names Ja'far, he names him this name because this name suits Ja'far al-Sadiq, alayhi salam. And his name is picked before he even exists, before he exists in this world, yeah, as the rawayat tell us. When Ali alayhi salam names Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, he knows he's naming him this name because this name suits the character of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Like, what's the name Abbas mean? Listen to the name of Abbas. Al-Abbas comes from the word Abasa. And the word Abasa is what we call Sighat Mubalagha, which means what? It's an exaggerated form for the verb. It's an exaggerated form for the verb. So if Abasa was 1 degree, the exaggerated form was a higher degree where someone who is called Abbas frowns a lot. It's a person who has a frown, and that frown is a lot. Jameel, why is Abbas even a name? Why would you call somebody that frowns a lot? Why would you call someone a name that means he frowns a lot? The one who frowns frequently. The reason is because in the Arab culture, the one who frowns is the one who stands up in front of the opposition, is the one that shows determination and courage in front of the opposition. The one who frowns is not a coward. The coward runs, turns away and runs. The one who frowns is the one that has courage. It's the one that frowns in the face of the opponent and stays steady and firm in his place. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, my brothers and sisters, didn't just do abus or al-abs once. He didn't just do abasa once. Abbas constantly was in the face of the opposition. And that speaks of his courage. Jameel. As for what they call Abbas, another meaning for Al-Abbas, they say in the Arabic dictionaries, Al-Abbas huwa al-asad allati tahabuhu al-usud. Al-Abbas is the lion that the lions fear. The lion that the lions themselves fear. Yani the lion that all of the other lions look out for when he steps on the battlefield. And this was Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam. Sallallahu alayhi wa Muhammad. As for how al-Abbas looked, then don't go far, for they used to call him Qamar Bani Hashim. He had bold features, a white, shining face, a beautiful face, to the degree where Umm al-Baneen, she had to recite a hariz, ta'weed, for Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas to protect him from the eyes of the envious. She used to say to him, "U'idhuhu bil-wahid min 'ayni kulli hasid." I seek protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to my son Abbas, for my son Abbas, from the eyes of the envious ones. Qa'imuhum wal-qa'id, muslimuhum wal-jahid. Those of them that stand, those of them that sit, those of them that are Muslims, those of them that are kafirs. Sadiruhum wal-warid, mawliduhum wal-walid. She says, those that come, those that go of them, those that have given birth, and those that have just come to this world. It said Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was not only beautiful in his face, his body was complete, and not just complete, strong. He had a wide chest. He had big arms, wide arms. And it said Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, according to the Rawayat, if he sat on a horse, his feet could touch the ground. Like, you're telling me, that's insane. That's crazy. That's too much. That's an exaggeration. Come to me. Come. And we're going to calculate exactly how tall Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam was to see, is that an exaggeration or is it actually real? It said the Arabian horse from the saddle to the ground is 5 feet. Meaning Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas from his hip to the ground had to at least have been 5 feet. Jameel. The human being, the lower half of the human being is 70% of the overall height of the human being. Yani from your hip to the bottom of your feet is about 70% of your overall height. About 70%. Some people maybe 60, 40, but 70% for someone that's tall. Jameel, when you do the calculation of the top half of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, it comes out that he was 3.5 feet tall, or 3.5 feet tall from the half up, meaning 5 feet plus 3.5 feet is 8.5 feet tall. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was 8.5 feet tall according to the simple calculation. Tell me that's too much. I'll tell you, the largest, tallest person in history was 8'11". So it's not an exaggeration. Robert Wadlow, a man that was living in Illinois, I would say between 60 to 80, maybe even 100 years ago, was 8'11". Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was 8.5 feet tall in and around 8.5 feet tall. Imagine a man 8.5 feet tall standing on the plains of Karbala, looking towards the armies in front of the Euphrates River. Imagine this man riding a horse towards the Euphrates River. How many men was Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas able to push back? When we say that Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was a one-man army, my brothers and sisters, this is not an exaggeration. You know who was like Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas in his height and his size? Hamza. Some ruwayat say al-Hamza was like Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas in his body, that his feet would touch the ground, can touch the ground. Imagine this man on the plains of Karbala. What was he able to do? That's why Imam Ali alayhi salam had immense trust in the abilities of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Ruwayat say that Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas fought with Amir al-Mu'mineen in the Battle of Nahrawan. It said Imam Ali alayhi salam was the Khalifa of the Muslimin for 5 years or so. He took the reins of Khilafah from Uthman for about 5 years. In those 5 years, Amir al-Mu'mineen fought 3 civil wars. The first one was Jamal. The second one was Safin. Third one was Nahrawan. First one was Jamal, who was with Aisha and Talha and Zubayr. Second one was with Muawiyah. Third one was with Al-Khawarij. Jameel. Al-Abbas alayhi salam was with Amir al-Mu'mineen in the Battle of Nahrawan, according to some traditions. And it said Nahrawan was a place near modern day Baghdad. Jameel. In Nahrawan, my brothers and sisters, there was a bridge. And that bridge was al-fasil, the barrier between the army of Amir al-Mu'mineen and the army of the Khawarij. The Khawarij, my brothers and sisters, in the beginning were in opposition to Imam Ali alayhi salam. They were vocal opposition. They used to speak out against Imam Ali. And Imam Ali alayhi salam, for the most part, said, no problem. You can be in opposition. Just don't kill anyone. Don't be unjust towards anyone. And we won't kill you, or nor will we hurt you, nor will we persecute you. They ended up committing murder, atrocities, killing, left, right, center. They killed anybody that loved Imam Ali alayhi salam. And even Abdullah ibn Khabbab, who was one of the companions in the Shias of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, or one of the Shias of Amir al-Mu'mineen, if not the Shias, one of the lovers of Ali ibn Abi Talib, they killed him, his wife, and his wife was pregnant. They cut her open and killed the child as well. These were the Khawarij. So they were not only were they violent, they were savages. Imam Ali fights them in Nahrawan. Al-Abbas alayhi salam was with his father in Nahrawan. Al-Abbas alayhi salam was given a task by Imam Ali. Him along with some of the soldiers of Imam Ali's army. He told Al-Abbas, I want you to stand on the bridge and don't let the Khawarij cross the bridge. Imam Ali alayhi salam set up his men on the forefront, his son Al-Abbas on the bridge. Imam Ali alayhi salam goes back to his post. It said Imam Ali alayhi salam is in his post and it's Dhuhr time. Imam Ali alayhi salam gets up to do wudu. He starts doing wudu and a man comes from the direction of the bridge. A horseman comes to Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. Imam Ali is still doing wudu, huh? The man looks at Imam Ali alayhi salam and he says to him, they crossed the bridge. Your men didn't hold up. Imam Ali alayhi salam didn't even look at him. He kept doing his wudu. Imam Ali alayhi salam was so sure of the abilities of Abu al-Fadl, he didn't even look at him. He ignored him. He kept doing wudu, his wudu, until he said, they didn't cross, nor will they cross. We will kill all of them except a number less than 10. And they will kill a number of us less than 10. They won't kill except a number of us less than 10. And we will kill all of them except a number of them less than 10. After some time, another Faris, another horseman, he comes to Imam Ali alayhi salam and he says, no, the blockade is still there. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas held them back. It said Imam Ali alayhi salam prays Salat al-Dhuhr. One of the men with Imam Ali, he had doubt in his heart. And he said, I had doubt in my heart. Did I trust Ali ibn Abi Talib? I had doubt. When he told us the exact number of the people we will kill of them and how much they will kill of us, I said, this will be the proof. Imam Ali alayhi salam finishes Salat al-Dhuhr. He gets his men ready. He goes down to the bridge. The men, the Khawarij, did not pass the bridge. Abu Fadl Abbas held his place. Imam Ali alayhi salam and his men, they charge one charge and they kill all of them except 9. And of the men of Imam Ali alayhi salam, only 9 were killed. A number less than 10. That's why Abu Fadl Abbas is named Sab' al-Qantara. Amongst our Iraqi brothers and sisters, they call Abu Fadl Abbas Sab' al-Qantara. The word Qantara, in the Fusha language, it's Al-Qantara. And Al-Qantara is a bridge. Sab' al-Qantara, or Sab' al-Qantara, is the lion of the bridge. The lion of the bridge. Amongst all of the men with Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, Al-Abbas was the lion that the lions feared. This was Al-Abbas. But with that pride, with that trust that Imam Ali alayhi salam had for Abu al-Fadl Abbas, there was sorrow. There was hurt. There was pain. The riwayah says Imam Ali alayhi salam once was sitting with Abu al-Fadl Abbas, and Abu al-Fadl Abbas was young. And the hands of Abu al-Fadl Abbas were showing, the wrists of Abu al-Fadl Abbas were showing. Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam was kissing those wrists and crying. Umm al-Baneen alayhi salam, she comes to Imam Ali. She says, why are you crying, Ya Ali? So he says to her, Ya Umm al-Baneen, I cry for what is to happen to these wrists. She says, and what's going to happen to these wrists? he says they are going to be cut. They're going to be cut, fighting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fighting for Islam. Naam, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam, his role was set out for him from the very first day. From the very first day he came to this world, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam's role was set out for him, and that is to protect Ahlul Bayt, to protect Abi Abdullah, to protect the camp of Abi Abdullah al-Hussain alayhi salam. And that's why Imam al-Hussain didn't give permission to Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas to go down to the battlefield and fight. After they lost Ali al-Akbar, after they lost al-Qasim, after they lost the Ashab, the companions, none were left except two. Abu al-Fadl and Abdullah al-Radiyah. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas comes to Imam al-Hussain. He says, "Ya Hussain, give me permission to go down and fight." Imam alayhi salam looks at his brother, a hopeless look, and he says to him, "Ya akhi, anta sahibu liwa'i. My brother, you're the bearer of my flag." Al-Abbas said, "I'm sick and tired of these hypocrites. I want to exact my revenge on them." Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam then ordered Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas to get water for the children. Al-Abbas went to the people, he advised them, reminded them of the truth, warned them from the anger of Allah. Umar ibn Sa'd responded to Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Shimr ibn Dhiljawshan screamed, "O son of Abi Turab, if the earth was filled with water and the water was under our control, we wouldn't give you a drop of water until you pledge allegiance to Yazid." Al-Abbas returned and told the Imam of what they said. He heard the children scream from their thirst. They were screaming, "Al-Atash, Al-Atash." Abu al-Fadl couldn't take it anymore. He couldn't stand hearing their voices. It was time to get water for the children, even if he had to fight the enemies alone. It said that Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas went down to the battlefield, stood in front of the enemies. In the eyes of Abu al-Fadl, there were 1,000 men waiting to feel the wrath of Allah on his hand. In their eyes, they saw a tall man whose body blocked the sun, but whose face shined like the moon. He raises his sword and death rains down on the men. It said he went to a hill. He turned towards Najaf to Amir al-Mu'mineen and screamed, "Aba ya Ali, Aba ya Ali, Aba ya Ali, hadha al-yawm alladhi dakhartani la. Ya Ali, ya Ali, ya Ali, this is the day you saved me for. Have I given the sword? It's right, ya Ali." Imam al-Hussein heard al-Abbas. His heart broke for al-Abbas. So he grabbed him and brought him back to the camp. As they're walking, Sayyidah Zainab sees them both coming back. And the Imam alayhi salam holding the hands of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. She went to Kulthum. And they said to one another, "Sister, when they come back, hold on to them. And we won't let them go anywhere." When they came inside the tent, Sayyidah Zainab held on to Imam al-Hussein's hand. And Kulthum held on to Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas and sat him down. Each sister held on to her brother. A man from the enemy screams, "Ya Hussein, Ya Abbas, أَجَبِمْتُمَا وَجَلَسْتُمَا بِقُرْبِ النِّسَاءِ." "Oh Hussein, oh Abbas, have you become cowards and decided to sit with the women?" At this point, Al-Abbas stood. Umm Kulthum wanted to hold him down. So Imam al-Hussein shouted, Ukhayya da'i, faqad ishtaq al-habibu ila habibih. Oh, my sister, leave him. For Ahlul Bayt, Ali, Fatima, Hassan, Rasulullah, they miss Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. It's time for Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas to meet them. Al-Abbas rode his horse. He took a skin container to fill with water. 4,000 soldiers were on the Euphrates River, and they started to attack Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Al-Abbas wasn't afraid of their number. He attacked them. The men didn't know if this was Karbala or Safin. Was it one man attacking them or an entire army? Did Allah send the angel of death to defend Imam al-Hussein? Or was it the day of judgment? Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was destroying the armies. After splitting the army, he reached the Euphrates River and went down towards the water. Being in the water, he saw how it sparkled and how the thirst was burning him from the inside. He picked up the water in his hands, but remembered the imam and the thirsty children. He remembered Sukaina. He remembered Abdullah al-Radi'. He remembered the thirst of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. He threw the water from his hands and he said his famous lines, Ya nafsu min ba'd al-Hussein huni wa ba'dahu la kunti antakuni. هذا حسين وارد المنون وتشربين بارد المعين تالله ما هذا فعل ديني. O soul, after Hussein you have no worth. May you not live after Hussein. Hussein is approaching his death and you drink the cold flowing water. By Allah, this is not an act of my religion. Al-Abbas fills the container. He gets on his horse and begins returning to the camp. Many soldiers stood in front of Al-Abbas, preventing him from reaching the camp. Al-Abbas attacked and killed many of them. He pushed them away and destroyed them, saying, La arhabu al-maut, idh al-maut zaqah, hatta uari fil musaliyati laqah, hatta uari fil musali fil masaliyati laqah, nafsi li sibt al-mustafa al-tuhri waqah, inni ana al-Abbas, aghdu بالسقى ولا أخاف الشر يوم الملتقى. Al-Abbas alayhi salam was saying, I have come and I don't fear death. I strike you with my sword to bring the water to Hussein and the children. I don't fear you, nor do I fear your numbers, and you will see my sword once it touches you. It said Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas takes a path towards the camp through the palm trees. It said Zayd ibn Ruqayd al-Jinani hid behind the palm tree while Hakim ibn al-Tufayl was helping him. They were waiting for al-Abbas to ride by the trees. As al-Abbas rode by the first tree to his right, the man saw the arm of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, as if it was calling him, huh? He gripped his sword, he raised the blade, and as Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was coming by the tree, he hit the hand of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. The hand of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas fell to the ground. When he felt his hand fall from his arm, he said his famous lines, Wallahi in qata'tumu yamini, in إني أحامي أبدا عن ديني وعن إمام صادق اليقين نجل النبي الطاهر الأمين. By Allah, If you cut my right hand, I will certainly continue defending my religion. And an imam who has certainty, the true certainty, the son of the pure, trustworthy prophet. Al-Abbas grabbed his sword with the left hand. He continues his way. His only worry was to get the imam the water. Hakim ibn Tufail hid behind another palm tree. When Al-Abbas came by his tree, Hakim raised his sword. He aimed for the hand and severed the left hand of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. The hand fell from Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, and the blood began flowing from the hand of Abu al-Fadl. He turned and he said, Ya nafsi, la nafsi. لا تخشي من الجب من الكفار وأبشري برحمة الجبار مع النبي المصطفى المختار قد قطعوا ببغيهم يساري. Also, don't fear the wicked and have glad tidings for reaching the mercy of Allah. They have cut my left arm. Ya Allah, let them feel the heat of the fire. His only worry was to get the water to the imam. He began rushing. Many soldiers gathered around Al-Abbas. When Umar ibn Sa'd saw Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas rushing, he called out, throw arrows at the container. If a drop of water reaches Hussein, none of you will stay alive. Arrows were coming at Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas like rain. An arrow pierced the container. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas now stops. He's confused. Does he go forward? Does he go back to get water? An arrow pierced through his chest. An arrow then hit his right eye. The blood of the right eye covered the left eye. Now he has no hands, no water, no eyes. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas bends down to take the arrow out of his eye with his knees. At this point, the helmet of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas falls from his head. One of the enemies comes from around Abu al-Fadl and strikes Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas on his head. He fell calling out for the first time in his life. Alayka minni salam ya Aba Abdullah. Adrikni ya akhi ya Hussein. Ya akhi Hussein, brother Hussein. Save me, Imam al-Hussein. When he heard the call of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, he said, الآن انكسر ظهري الآن قلت حيلتي. Now is the time where my back has broke. I can see no way out, and the enemies are happy at what's happening to me. The Imam rode until he stopped on the way. He went down and picked something off the ground and kissed it. He rode some more. He found something on the ground. He went down and put it to his mouth and kissed it. What were those two things? They were the hands of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. He got to his brother and saw him on the ground. No hands, no eye. An arrow in his chest, his head split in two. The blood covered one eye of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, while the other eye had an arrow in it. When Imam al-Hussein came close to his brother, al-Abbas thought he was one of the enemies coming to kill him. So he said to him, oh, you that's there, give me a bit of time just to see my brother Hussein. The Imam cried and said, I'm your brother, Ya Abbas. The Imam sat by his brother's side. Here's the tragedy. Here's the musibah. He put his brother's head, in his lap. Feeling this, Al-Abbas moved his head from the lap of the Imam. The Imam did it again. But Al-Abbas moved his head once again and put it on the sand. For a third time, the Imam placed his head on his lap. But Al-Abbas moved it again and put it on the sand. Imam al-Hussein said, Brother Abbas, why do I see you doing this? Look what he says to him. He says, brother, O light of my eye, yabn ya akhi ya nur ayni, how can I not do this? And right now you've come to me and you've taken my head. However, after a while, who will raise your head off the sand, ya Hussein? Who will wipe the sand off your face, ya Hussein? The Imam wanted to bend down to carry Abu al-Fadl back to the camp. Al-Abbas opened his eyes and saw that the Imam was trying to carry him. Rather, he opened one eye and he saw the Imam wanting to carry him. He said, where do you want to take me, Ya Hussein? The Imam said to him, back to the camp. He said, Ya Hussein, Ya Akhi, by the right of your grandfather, Rasulullah, don't carry me, leave me where I am. Why, Ya Abu al-Fadl? He said, there are two reasons. The first reason, as I promised Sukaina water, and if I didn't bring her water, I was going to be ashamed to see her. And the second reason is because death has come to me, Ya Hussein. Leave me to die at the Euphrates rivers, as if he says to him. The Imam leaves his brother. He comes back to the camp. Who does he meet? The first person he sees is his daughter, Sukaina, who says to him, father, did my uncle Abbas get us some water? So the Imam replied, A'azham Allahu laki al-ajr ya Sukaina bil-Abbas, bi'ammik al-Abbas. May Allah reward you, Ya Sukaina, with the death of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, Ya Allah. We ask you, Ya Allah, by the right of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, accept this majlis from us, Ya Allah. Accept our amal, Ya Allah. Forgive us for our sins, Ya Allah. Heal the sick, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Heal the sick that we know from our community and those from other communities. Heal all the believers, Ya Allah, specifically those that are suffering from cancer, from terminal diseases, chronic diseases, Ya Allah, and from coronavirus, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Accept this majlis from us. Accept our amal, accept our salat. Make our parents and sahib al-asri wa-zaman proud of us, Ya Allah. Make us from those who follow in the footsteps of Abi al-Fadl al-Abbas, Ya Allah. Let's all of us turn to sahib al-asri wa-zaman together, recite dua al-faraj. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين صلى على محمد. Let's recite سورة المباركة الفاتحة للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والشهداء والعلماء before it aloud صلوات على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل.
Thank you, Sheikh, for the enlightening lecture. Thank you everyone for attending tonight's session, and make sure you tune in tomorrow evening at 9:30 p.m. We look forward to your attendance, and with that, tonight's session is ending. See you tomorrow, inshallah.